show exclusively known as the voice of the Arizona Cardinals fan club, the Bird Gang.
Fitzgerald inside the 30, the 20, there is Fitzgerald. It's insane.
Now with your host, Earl Burnett, a.k.a. Kazual E.
Bird Gang on three. One, two, three. Bird Gang.
What up, Bird Gang, Suns Nation, all you wonderful sports friends out there, sports fans out there. It is Friday, and we have made it through another week. Man, we've made it through another week, and this is the Kazual Sportz Show. Earl Burnett got my co-host going to sit in with me, my man Ed Cole from the Insight Sports Talk, and we got a lot to get to, so let me go ahead and get the business out the way first. This show is brought to you by the folks at CASA, court-appointed special advocates, Change a Child's Story, and many, many children out there need a change. And we need some volunteers to get out and help in the foster system and help some of these children have some form of normal life going forward. If you want to get more information about that and get some information about CASA, go ahead and go to our website, www.ksrnaz.com, or you can go ahead and shoot me a call, 602-563-KSRN, 602-563-KSRN, that's 5776 if you don't know. Also brought to you by Customer First Solutions. Not only do you as a customer come first, but your home is first priority as well. Customer First Solutions, the one-stop spot for all your home care needs. Handyman services, painting, plumbing, electrical, and more. Give them a call, 480-877-0255 for an appointment. You can set up via text, 480-877-0255. Customer First Solutions, the old saying still true, customers always first. You want to join us on Facebook Live or join us and follow us on any of our four major outlets, go ahead and hit us up on our four major outlets of Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and our YouTube page. And also download the apps, the mobile apps for Android and iPhone at the website www.ksrnaz.com. And if you haven't done so already, please subscribe. Man, that's a mouthload. But here we are, man. Welcome, man, Ed, for coming in again. Appreciate it.
Brother Earl, thanks for having me on, man. Appreciate it.
No problem, man. I feel like we was just on the radio, doesn't it?
Yeah, it was. Just about 7 hours ago, yes, we were.
7 hours ago, something like that, yeah. Oh, man. But, yeah, it's Friday, man. And let's go ahead. Something that's never been done and something that's taboo in radio, and that's silence. But I want to take a moment of silence and give some silence for the 9/11 victims. Just let's take a moment of silence for 9/11 overall. All right. That probably has never been done in radio, but definitely worth it, man. And I can remember 9/11, man. A lot of lives changed overnight. I mean, wow. That's something that was tough to get up to and walk and get up to see on television, trying to catch up to it because I was behind on hearing about it. But I was like, what is going on? Like the world was coming to an end. And next thing you know, you see these planes just on a news just hitting one after you, like, what is going on? It felt like a movie. I was dreaming of something.
Yeah,
it was horrible.
And Earl, and my family and I, we live back in DC, we're from Maryland, so we were back in the DMV back then when it happened.
Okay.
And we were pregnant with our oldest child.
Oh, wow.
Cameron. About 2 months later he was born. So it happened, and I was at a different workplace, obviously, than my wife, Adrienne, was.
Right.
So I'm busy texting her and calling her and trying to figure out where she is, because once the thing happened in New York,
right,
and then the plane flew into the Pentagon,
right,
then, I mean, all heck broke loose.
Right.
And we're just freaking out trying to text each other and figure where we were, because she's pregnant. She's almost about ready to deliver Cameron. So,
man,
you know, so we're just scrambling and trying to figure out where we were. But thank the Lord we got together that night and everything was safe, at least on our end. But yeah, we have to pay homage and tribute to all the lives that were lost,
right,
just in those three horrific attacks that also happened in Pennsylvania as well.
Exactly.
It was just
exactly.
And for it to be 19 years that it happened, Earl, Man, time 19, just flies
wow,
by.
Wow, man, that just let me know how old I am, first of all. Second of all, that is a long time. That is, man, that, it just seems like it was yesterday. I mean, we know it wasn't, but it feels like it wasn't that long ago. But 19 years, wow.
19 years.
You know, the scariest.
And in my mind, it just like it happened yesterday.
Exactly. And the scariest thing about that to me, of course, was nobody knew what was coming and how many planes they had taken over. And then it was like, okay, something could be coming right down right now. Nobody knew, because first I thought it was just they were hitting major spots. Then you heard the one go down on the ground in was it Pennsylvania, you said?
Pennsylvania, yeah. Yes.
Yep. You're like, okay, if they just shooting them to the ground, now you're like, I mean, I was on the freeway. I remember I'm in California on the 101 freeway looking up and down like, what is going on, man? It was bad. It was something else. But, yeah, man. Man, 19 years, though.
Yes.
That's something else. But, yeah, man.
Our hearts and prayers go out to all the families.
That's what I was trying to. The words don't come out. It's like, man, what can you even say about something like that for all those families that got flipped upside down in one night? I mean, one day, and then the families of people that just go to work normal, and next thing you know, they're not there, and it's like, wow, that was tough, man. That was really tough.
Yes, it was.
That was really tough. I don't think we've seen anything like that since then, but we've had some moments. But this COVID-19 thing is starting to have its own little deal, and then we got some things going on in sports and things around the world is going on in that we'll talk about in a minute. But before I do that, let me go ahead and go into something I like to call the Bird Gang News. I got a few announcements I'm going to make here, so just hold on one quick second because we got to take care of this news.
Ladies and gentlemen, can I please have your attention? I've just been handed an urgent
Bird Gang
news story. And I need all of you to stop what you're doing and listen. And listen, and listen.
All right, Bird Gang, Suns Nation, fans out there, we got some announcements to drop for you real quick. I got a couple of events that are going on charity-wise that I want you guys to pay attention to out there. Our good folks at the Be Daring Foundation are dropping a virtual event that normally is done at an actual location, but of course, you know, due to COVID-19, everything is gone behind the computer screen. So a virtual summit. It's called the Pave the Way Summit. This is a mental health summit. My girl down at the Be Daring Foundation does an awesome job about making awareness about mental illness and mental health. Now, this is just hitting home right on the point, right at the right time, because a lot of this mental health stuff is starting to pop up, and guys are starting to come out of the woodworks and say, hey, I have this. I need to deal with this. I mean, that interview with Dak Prescott the other night was excellent. I mean, it ain't just the superstars. It's everybody has somebody dealing with this, so reach out to my girl at Be Daring Foundation. Her name is Michelle Demaria. You can catch her on Facebook under Be Daring Foundation. That's B as in B, like the buzz, B-E-E, Daring Foundation. That's going down November 4th through the 7th. 3 days called the Pave the Way Summit, where they'll have events like guest speakers, workshops, virtual networking, and social media campaigns. And they'll have a guest speaker as well that's sponsoring the whole thing. So Michelle Demaria is putting that on for all those that know somebody and have somebody and should bring somebody that is dealing with mental health illness. So she does an awesome job with that. The next announcement I got, of course, has got to go to you Bird Gang people out there. Patrick Peterson is doing his special, special, special charity that he is honoring. He is honoring the legacy of Kobe Bryant, who in L.A. did a lot for homeless people. And P2 is doing his part here in Arizona. He is going to start this week, every Tuesday during the season. He is going out to the homeless shelters of U-Moms, the U-Moms shelters around the valley every Tuesday to feed the homeless. Bird Gang, he wants you to come out to those shelters and help him feed the homeless. You can volunteer, and you can also donate to this cause as well. Just go to umoms.com, or .org, I should say. Sorry, umoms.org for more information. And please do me a favor. Don't crowd P2 trying to get autographs and things like that. He's down there to do a service to the community, and we want to just go down there and support him as the Bird Gang always does for everything that goes on in the Valley. So go ahead and go to U Moms. That's the letter U and moms.org for more information on that. And, of course, Bird Gang, you know the Cardinals have the stadium closed down the first two home games, but when they do open it up, you want to be ready. Get your mask from my boy Mike Durarte. He has a good selection of masks. Everything you can think of, players, the beak from the Cardinal, everything you can think of, he has it on a mask for the Bird Gang. So let's support our Bird Gang, guys, and go to Mike Durarte on Facebook, M-I-K-E. Durarte is Y-D-U-A-R-T-E. And you can catch him also on Instagram with the same address. Those are our Bird Gang news. Keep that stuff in your heads this week, Bird Gang. All right. Appreciate you hanging around for that, Ed. That's usually what we do around here.
All right. Yeah, you got to take care of the business first.
Do what you got to do, exactly. So now I'm going to go right into that and see what's going on in this crazy world of COVID-19 sports.
Casual House.
Oh, a lot's going down right now. There's a heck of a game going down. Boston looks like they're starting to pull away to try to go ahead and win that game seven. A good game went down earlier today as well. But let me go ahead and start with the NBA bubble. And Ed, I want you, dude, since you are here as a co-host and you broke this news to me as I'm on the road driving all the way down to Casa Grande trying to get my kids. Hey, somebody got sent home from the bubble, man, and somebody got, like, a high school student got suspended from the bubble and sent home. Give us some news on that and who this guy is and what the hell happened.
Yeah, it was crazy. Rockets player Donnell House, he got sent home for violating the bubble, the rules of the bubble. He had an unauthorized guest in his room they said for several hours.
Oh,
so
no.
I don't know if that was a young lady he had in the room, but for several hours, I don't want to assume anything, but, you know, I'm just assuming. I'm thinking it may be a young lady he had in his room. He's maybe snuck a young lady, or it could have been a family member, but I'm thinking it's probably a young lady he brought in the room.
Exactly.
But he was clearly in violation of the rules.
Yes.
House did. So the NBA came down hard on him and sent him home.
Bye-bye.
So he's done.
Oh, man. It was only a matter of time before one knucklehead would jump up and screw and get caught for something. You knew it was coming.
Yep.
You just knew, okay, this is going too easy. Something's been a crack somewhere. And bam, there's one. So there's the first one.
And how disappointing is that for the Houston Rockets to lose? And he was a major cog in them getting to where they are with the Los Angeles Lakers, Earl.
Man.
And for them to lose him right now when they desperately need him, they're down 3-1 in this series. They're taking the Lakers on tomorrow night. They need all hands on deck. And for House to be thinking only of himself, clearly, and bringing an unauthorized guest in his room, he violated it. It was his fault. Then he should pay the price. And the NBA booted him out. He's gone. And the Rockets will be without his services for game five. And that's just so disappointing that he did that. And he let the entire Houston Rockets organization down by doing that.
You know what, Ed, though? Answer this for me and tell me if this is kind of somewhat on point. I was listening to the finishing of a PLR today, and he hit on some things about this Rocket team that I am like 100% behind. I mean, everything he says about the Rockets, I'm like a mirror copy of it. But when you see that happen, isn't that something that gives you an inkling that there's some stuff going on in that organization? The guys have quit, and it feels like they have quit. That game they put on that display, how they played in that game, a crucial game that they could pull even in that series, and they come out and play lethargic, and they come out and play with like they had no interest in the game at all. And you can tell there may be something going on between coaching staff and player because it seems like the players have closed D'Antoni out. And something like that happening, a player saying, I don't give a dang no more, and they just do what they want to do. They don't care anymore. And it feels like that's where the Rockets are right now. Players don't care anymore. And they've already checked out. It seems like to me they've checked out that this series is not going any further at the next game. It seems like they've checked out because the way they played that game feels like they checked out. And so that happening tells me, oh, they've checked out a long time ago.
I would hate to say that. And actually, that would actually come to light that a guy like James Harden or Eric Gordon or Russell Westbrook, any of those guys just totally just spaced and just totally just blocked off Mike D'Antoni,
right,
and just are not with this Rockets organization anymore. Like House, he went on his own. He went rogue and brought somebody into his room, clearly violating the NBA rules in the bubble, right, and now he's gone.
Right.
So, yeah, that's very disrespectful for him to do that. And if these players, in fact, have checked out on Mike D'Antoni, his time is done there.
Yes.
Because if the players don't trust him and the players don't believe him,
right,
who's going to go first, the coaches or the players?
Exactly.
Of course, the coach is going to go.
As media, you know, we do a lot of – everything we do has to be backed up, of course, by facts, okay? But there's a lot of things we do that we look into things and kind of read into things. You can look at a person's body language and just know something's not right. That interview that Harden did yesterday, something felt like – to me, it just felt like it was like – when the question they were asking him, he was like, you know, whatever, okay – whatever. You know, it was like a no-care attitude. It seems like, it feels like to me, it's like, we've been running this system every year since I've been here in the playoffs, and it has not gotten us over the hump.
Right.
I think there's a lot of failing of this system to this team. The team is starting to look at that coach and like, where are your adjustments at? What are we doing to change anything? And we're the same damn team coming out here jacking up 63s a game and trying to rely on Harden to take all the shots. That's not going to win you no series in the second round against a team like that.
No, have not they, against the Lakers.
Exactly, no. Exactly. So have they gave up on their coach to the point where, like, this system is not working?
Without them actually coming out and saying yes, we gave
exactly
up on Mike D'Antoni,
exactly,
we can only speculate, and we can only, right, from their body language and from, right, what they say to the media and what we see on the court, we can only surmise that possibly they have checked out on Mike D'Antoni, and they are done with what is going on with the Houston Rockets, because maybe they feel and they know that D'Antoni is taking them as far as he's going to take them.
Right. Could it also be another excuse for James Harden to put the blame on somebody else? Not saying he's doing this. I'm just saying, remember, he's got a reputation of big game, not show up in the playoffs. Playoffs.
Right.
And so here we are again. That was a major game that they needed to play and win and come out.
And Earl, If he didn't hit 16 free throws, his 2-for-11, the 2-for-11 just abysmal shooting,
wow,
they would have lost by more than 10
exactly
points. It would have been worse than that.
Exactly. And from hearing what Paul is talking about, that he took 11 shots, I said, that's not
shots.
James Harden. I said, no
that's
way.
That's not James Harden. No.
I said, no way. I said, dude checked out. I don't know. I'm just telling you. He ain't going to admit it, and the players are not going to come out in the media and admit it, but that dude checked out because – he looked like he feels like he's beating himself up trying to get this team over the hump, and that system will not allow it. And to take 11 shots and you're the superstar on that team, that says a lot to me. Were the Lakers doing anything that different, D'ing him up? No. You knew what was coming. So, I don't know.
Yeah.
That just seems mind-boggling to me that a guy that usually takes that, you know, double or triple that in a game is only taking 11 shots. So
he usually takes 11 shots in a quarter,
in a
quarter, if not more.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly. So something's amiss in Houston. And I know this, I got a feeling this is definitely the last year of D'Antoni. And I'm hoping, and I don't want to, you know, put a guy down because he's a good coach, you know, regular season-wise and excitement type-wise during the regular season. But I hope that system is out this NBA. I'm sorry, I just do. I hope that system is long gone and nobody else tries to duplicate that crap because that is a recipe for disaster in the playoffs.
It is.
I mean, three-point shooting is so up and down. How can you rely on three-point shooting every night? It's impossible. So, man, I just hate to see.
That's what the Houston Rockets live and die for. They live and die
do
on the three-pointers. We saw it last year in the playoffs
against
the Golden State Warriors when they missed 27 straight three-pointers. So when you miss 27 straight three-pointers, that shows you that is your entire offense. That's all you run, and that's what you live and die on. Like you said, Earl, three-pointers, and when they do not hit, you're done.
Man, let's give an update what's going on with the Celtics and Raptors right now. It is a 7-point lead for the Celtics, 85-78, with 6 minutes to go, but don't think that game's over. Trust me.
No, gosh, no.
Them two teams know how to lock it down.
But Earl, you're halfway through the fourth quarter, and the Toronto Raptors only have 7 points in the fourth quarter. What's that to say about the Celtics defense and what they're able to do when they shut those guys down? Lowry, only 12 points. Fred VanVleet, 20 points on 8 of 19 shooting. Wow. So they completely take it. Siakam's only got 10 points. Wow. So give credit to the Celtics defense locking those guys down.
That's it. That's what it comes down to.
Defense.
Yeah. One thing you can't rest on, when you were on the show last time, you said it. You can't rest on that being a champion. Don't underestimate that champion. Because I saw that day overtime game again. I'm like, wow, they should have lost that game. They should have lost that game. But if they do that championship stuff again tonight, and it usually starts happening in the last 5 minutes, because Boston's going to tighten up in that last 5 minutes, and all the shots are going to be, the baskets look like it's going to shrink.
Right.
And it's going to be
fun.
It's
not like this anymore.
Yeah,
it's tiny, this small.
It's going to feel like, it's like, okay, who can make a shot putting that big old thing in a small hole in there? You know that the saying goes.
Yeah, it's about as big as the head on a needle, right?
There you go. But that's going to be interesting. We'll keep an eye on that for you guys, just in case you're.
But should the Celtics pull out, that'll be a really good Eastern Conference Finals with the Celtics and the Heat. That'll be a great series.
You want to talk about blood, sweat, and tears?
Oh yes.
You talk about elbow swinging, you're going to be having a whole bunch of fights, bickering, and, you know, it's going to get crazy because both them teams scrap.
Yes, they do.
Oh, my goodness. And they got talent,
And they're both
too.
Championship organizations. Yes. They know how to win championships.
And they got talent. Oh, my goodness. They got some young
talent. And that's another series I could see going 7 games. I'd love to see a 7-game series out of that.
I got that one going 7 for sure.
Yeah.
For sure, I got that one.
Should the Celtics wrap this thing up? They're up 9 with about 5 minutes left, so it's looking good for Boston.
Oh,
but
yeah,
again,
Boston's starting to run away, but don't, like I said, wait for that last 5 to 4 minutes when they get tight. But I think the Boston Celtics we've let a lot of opportunities slip away. We cannot let this slip away.
No.
And so, I mean, for them to be in the Eastern Conference Finals 3 out of 4 years, they know how to get there, too. So it's not like they
– Oh, goodness, yes.
Yeah, it's not like they, you know, new to this, so –
Yeah, Brad Stevens is a fantastic coach, fantastic young coach.
Yeah.
He is taking those Boston Celtics, and he's just making that team his own. He's got that system in there, and it's working.
Which team
working
to
very
you?
Well.
Which team to you is in line for the next step to the championship? Boston or the Heat? I mean, because Boston, like I said, they've been around for a minute and they've been in that game for a while. But the Heat's like this new. Shiny little, oh, man, you know, those guys are going to get to a point where they're going to go, oh, my God, where are we at? What have we got ourselves into? You know, because they've never been there before. But we know Eric Spoelstra's been there before, and he knows what it looks like. So if the troops don't get rattled because of the leader not rattled, man, that could help too. So, but I see Boston being that team. But who do you see between those two teams being that one that's just
I see Boston finally making it to the NBA Finals against – possibly the Clippers.
Right.
You know, the Clippers slipped up and let Denver get that game last night. Tonight, they should have closed that game out. They had a 16-point lead.
What?
And they let Denver just absolutely whitewash them. And
they should have that was the next game we were coming through, the Denver and Clippers. I didn't get to see it. Like I said, I was on the road. But a 16-point lead in what? Is that the first half or is that the second half? They had a 16-point lead.
I believe it was in the second half. Then,
wow.
Then Paul Millsap went off in the third quarter. He had 14 points by himself in the third quarter, and that kind of lit the fire for the Denver Nuggets, and then they started hitting shots. Joker was hitting shots. Jamal Murray was hitting shots, and it was just infectious.
Wow.
Earl, everybody was just hitting shots, and then their defense clamped down on the Los Angeles Clippers, again, holding them to 105 points.
Okay.
Even though Kawhi got his. Kawhi had 36 tonight, but it was their defense down
box,
the stretch that locked them out.
I looked at the box score, and I see Kawhi and George did their thing, but nobody else really did anything. Defensively,
you know
they're doing something because they're always going to be in a game defensively. But they look like they let their defense fail them tonight. If they had a 16-point lead, let that team come back on them. What about Michael Porter Jr.? He had a lot to say before this game and some things he probably shouldn't have said in the media. But I heard he had a really crucial three that put this game away.
Yeah, he had a really crucial shot down the stretch, a 3-point shot, and he played really, really good defense down the stretch. He was 4 for 4 from the free throw line, which kept the Los Angeles Clippers at bay, and that helped the Denver Nuggets. But he came down really, really big, strong in the stretch.
So you got to give him
down in that fourth quarter.
Got to give him credit, man. If you're going to open your mouth, you got to back it up, and he backed it up.
And he did.
Yeah, so
yes,
that's
he did.
Good thing for a young player too. That's going to only bode more confidence for that young kid because he's going to be
absolutely.
He's going to be something. You can tell. He's just waiting for his time. Like, okay, yeah, y'all running it right now. He just sitting in the wings like, okay,
right.
Yeah, y'all go ahead and do it, Jokic and Murray. Yeah. Wait till they get a load of me. He's coming. But I like that kid. I thought we should have got him, even though they had the reports on his injury and all this. I thought we should have went and got him because it was a steal for anybody that got him because he could have been a number one pick if he had been healthy. He could have been the number one overall pick. But, yeah, the Clippers could have had him.
Now the Clippers wanted him too, yeah.
Yep. Okay, and another thing we got to jump to in news today, the MLB has another breakout of the COVID-19 on the team. The Giants and Padres have to postpone a game, and that brings us to 50 major league games postponed due to COVID-19 this year. How the hell are they going to make up 50 games? It's impossible. That's not going to happen, right? They're not going to make them games up. It's just going to go by the winning percentage, and whatever happens, happens, right?
Yeah, because there's no way that they're going to go past their cutoff date. I'm sure they have a specific cutoff date for the World Series. And I read an article where they're still weighing their options on the playoff bubble. And I'm pretty sure that's going to get passed, especially, you know, with this.
Yeah, they keep having these breakouts. Yeah, they got to have a bubble. Yeah,
they have to have a bubble.
Right.
You know, whether it's going to be – whether they're going to play in Texas and Arlington or wherever they're going to play. Maybe they play in California. Maybe they play in Anaheim or Los Angeles or wherever they decide to play.
Right.
It has to be a bubble situation, right, Earl?
I think so.
They can't have these teams traveling all over the country for the playoffs and then the World Series, and then there's another outbreak in the most crucial series.
And you got to give
your season.
Yeah, you got to give each of these teams the chance to have a fair shot to win that title, and you don't want nobody to get taken out because of COVID-19. I mean, that would be horrible in a playoff series.
Yeah.
Man, yeah. I would imagine the bubble is in the works, and it got to be in the works and got to be done quick because this thing is almost over. They got, 15 games left? 15 to 17 games left in that season? I know the Diamondbacks have 17 or 15 left. It doesn't really matter, but other teams that are fighting for something, there's some...
There's about 14, 15
games
left.
Yeah, so... They better hurry up and get that dang thing figured out because that's going to be here before you know it in baseball. They playing so many games like crazy. It's, you know, it goes by fast.
Man, does it.
But I'm going to take a quick break here. We're going to take some a break for the Bird Gang here, and we can get back. We are going to talk Cardinals preview of the 49ers game, and a former Cardinal just kind of warmed our hearts here in a game last night. Stick around, Bird Gang. We'll be right back. Kazual Sportz Show, Earl Burnett, Ed Coast sitting in as a co-host. We'll be right back.
Heart. It's beating a little faster because it belongs to a young child. But this child isn't in the middle of a close soccer game.
That's good stuff,
or
bro.
Playing with her puppy in the yard. Her heart is racing because she's just been told she has to move foster homes again. Change a child's story. There's a child waiting for a volunteer like you. Learn how you can help at CasaForChildren.org.
Richard of Nottingham.
Well, speak up, man. What is it?
News from the East, sire.
Larry
has returned.
Stop. Lying.
Larry.
You need Larry.
Larry!
Send a message. Larry!
Vince Carroll
has returned.
This is Larry Fitzgerald. You're listening to the exclusive voice of the Bird Gang, Kazual Sportz. This is Cliff Kingsbury, and you're listening to the second best sounding voice in the valley, Kazual E, on the Kazual Sportz Show here on KSRN Arizona.
All right, Bird Gang, welcome back into the Kazual House. I love that Larry promo. Thank you to my man Larry for coming in and do that promo for us at his event. One day we did that event, put that down. It was pretty cool. But that's one thing that's going to continue on. No matter how long Larry does it, that's going to be here on this show regardless. That promo and his our intro, of course, is our is his famous run on the Green Bay Packers. I don't know if anybody ever noticed that. But our intro is Larry Fitzgerald's run against the Packers in that playoff game. And that's going to forever be on there. But he won't give us the insight about which one of those plays to him is the best, because he kind of downplays it every time we ask him. Come on, Larry, give me something. No, they're all the same, and, you know, I don't really think about that. And, come on, man. I say, which play? That one, the Green Bay one, or you running down the middle of the Super Bowl against the Steelers? Come on, tell me which one is the most memorable to you. Oh, I don't even think about all of that. Come on, man. You do.
Yeah, you know he's a humble dude, Earl. He's not gonna boast on himself.
I know.
But that run, that Super Bowl run was magnificent, wasn't it? It was magic. Woo. I got it in my mind right now. I'm just watching Larry do it right now.
Yeah, no. You were at that point in time, and I was like new to Arizona when that was going down. And I'm like, they finna actually win a Super Bowl? Like, what the? Wow, you know, but then that pedigree of that Steeler thing came through, and you know the rest of that story. I don't even like to go back to it. It's too heartbreaking to go back to.
I know.
But speaking of the man himself, Mr. Fitzgerald, put some stuff out there, said, if I win a championship, of course, I'm gone. I'm going to be gone. Y'all ain't going to see me around here. So I want him to win that championship, man. But I don't know if that's going to be this year, but this year can be the opportunity could be there with, you know, with COVID-19, the different things, how this thing looks. Nobody knows who's going to come out of this thing healthy. There's an opportunity. They could very well be that surpriser in that game, right?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. With none of the teams actually playing any preseason games.
Exactly.
And nobody really being really able to feel anybody out as far as their opponents go.
Right.
They could go to Santa Clara on Sunday and beat the 49ers.
Yes.
We talked about how good the 49ers are defensively.
Yes.
But offensively, outside of Raheem Mostert, they're all right.
They're, okay. They're all right.
and George like Kittle, that. They're all right.
Yeah, I like
you know, Jimmy
that.
G is good, but their wide receivers don't scare anybody.
Correct. Yeah, we'll talk about that because you're right on point with that. We'll talk about that. But let's just go back.
Of course, they play football better than you and I ever could.
Of course.
Any of those players.
Of course.
But
of course.
You know what I'm saying.
Yes, I know exactly what you're saying, bro. David Johnson, former Cardinal. You got to, I mean, tell me if you were feeling the way I was feeling watching that game. And then a lot of Cardinal fans, I looked on the social media, and a lot of these people, Cardinal fans, is feeling the same way. You kind of had your heart warmed a little bit, like you were rooting for him in a way, like, oh, go ahead, David, go ahead. You know, you were rooting for that kid. And I know. I did. I was like, go ahead, David, show him what's up. You know, and I just felt good that he got backed, or at least one game. You know, this sample size, we saw one game. But, man, they showed every run that he kept running. That jump step looks like 2016, I'm telling
you. Yes, sir.
And it looked so pretty. It looked so pretty. I was like, David, come on, man. Don't hurt him. What the heck? Where was that at the last 2 years?
Yeah. I was so happy for David last night. He looked so good. 11 rushes, 77 yards.
Yeah.
He got the game's opening score. 3 catches for 32 yards. So he had 109 yards of
total
all-purpose yards.
Yeah.
And he looked really, really good last night. He looked healthy. Like you said, Earl, he had that jump step.
Yeah.
He looked just like he was, like you said, 4 years ago
when
he first got here. That was shades of David Johnson in his rookie season. He looked really good.
He sure did.
You and I both know how good of a dude he is.
Yes.
That's a good brother
there. So many interviews with him and personal stuff off the record and off the interviews, just talking with him. Good dude.
Yeah.
The way this thing went down with him, the Cardinals tried to do it as nice as they could. And to hear Steve Kahn come out today and just say, I'm so glad for him to see him do it. I mean, that's good, man. I love that. But he was the bright spot for the Texans because I didn't see anything else outside of that. I mean, you can tell they definitely missed DeAndre Hopkins because they just doubled up on Fuller and forced and forced Watkins to just keep dunking all day, and that offense just looked like they were just dead after that first drive that David scored on.
Oh yeah, if David wasn't there and he didn't do what he did, then the score would have been worse than 34-20.
Yep.
Because once those Kansas City Chiefs, once Patrick Mahomes got his guys revved up and rolling, and they got that rookie, they discovered this kid, Clyde Edwards-Helaire.
Oh my goodness,
that kid was all. The Bengal Tiger last night.
The rich get richer.
Man,
that kid is amazing. And I knew he was going to be good when I saw him in college. I said, whoever gets this kid's going to be. And then when I saw Kansas City guy, I was like, oh my goodness. Andy Reid is looking for the next Westbrook. And there he is, right there.
Yes.
My goodness. Okay.
That's the guy right there.
Real quick. It's a 2-point lead. Celtics and Raptors.
What did I tell you? The champions.
Didn't
will
we
never
say
go
that?
Away.
You cannot. Yes. You cannot. When it gets tight, I said it. When it gets tight, Boston looked like they got tight. They haven't scored in a while. They've been on that same 89 for a minute. So.
Keep an eye on that one, Earl. In those situations, you got to go with the champions
because Toronto knows how to close games. And they going after it. You can tell. They're like, okay, yes. It's that time to turn it up. This team ain't used to what we know how to do, and they are turning it up on. I wish I could watch that. 34 seconds is left in the game, and they're up 2 points, Boston. Can they make the plays down the stretch and not choke it away?
Oh, buddy.
The champion always makes you find a way to choke it away. They just know how to come up and make big plays, but we'll keep that going. I'll keep you posted on that, but it's a 2-point game with 34 seconds left. But back,
yeah, I got it up on ESPN right here.
Oh, good. Yeah, so you if you see something jump out real excited, just yell it out. It don't matter. But yeah, going back to that Texans game, yeah, they were really missing Hopkins because remember, everybody keeps forgetting you can't just take a receiver off a team and say we're gonna be fine. Like Bill O'Brien keeps thinking he's gonna be fine. You can't just take a star guy off the team because guess what? That star guy was not just your star receiver; he was also your star decoy. And you took him off that team, and so now that you don't have that decoy to scheme around, everything that everybody schemed around playing the Texans was scheming around Hopkins. So they were mediocre when they took that guy off that team, right?
Yes. But it's not like they don't have talent, Earl, but not to the level of DeAndre Hopkins.
No way.
Will Fuller, the fifth, he's very good.
Yes.
Randall Cobb, he's good. Brandon Cooks is good. Darren Fells. They've got talent there. But when you lose a guy, like you said, like DeAndre Hopkins, this guy is – he's a top five receiver in the league. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely. Top three in my book. Top three at least.
Top three at least. So you've got him. You've got Michael Thomas, him, and who else?
I would say Julio – first.
Julio, yes.
I would go Julio, then I would go Michael Thomas, then I would go Hopkins, and then
you go
of course,
Julio over Michael Thomas?
Julio over, yes, absolutely. Yes. You better look at Julio's body of work. I mean, that kid, go back and look at everything that kid has accomplished, and then take me back to the Super Bowl. If the Falcons do the right thing, that play he made in the Super Bowl should have been the winning play of that game. The one on the sideline when he went up on the side, that was the winning play of that Super Bowl, but they choked it away. But that was the winning play. Of course Michael Thomas wants to be Julio Jones.
He's doing his best to do
and
it, too,
so
though,
right? is. Julio's been doing it a little long. Julio is the man. Oh, my God.
Oh,
he's
man,
the man.
Girl. Yeah, that, okay, that would be a toss-up for me. I could take Julio or Michael as number one.
You're going by what Michael Thomas has done the last year and how he's with Breeze because they're a winning team. Julio's been struggling with Atlanta for how long? Up and down, up and down, up and down. So he comes and goes. You don't get to see it. But he's still putting up the same numbers, if not better, every year. So – and that's one hell of a receiver right there. I'm sorry. I cannot put nothing over him right now. After that, I would go – I mean, they got Amari Cooper up there, but I don't see Cooper. I don't see Cooper being in the top three, four.
He's not a top five wide receiver.
No way. So why is he paid like the top three? He's the second highest paid receiver in the league right now.
Because he plays for the Dallas freaking Cowboys.
Exactly.
Yeah,
Good point.
That's why.
But all the other receivers behind those top three to me are just like all in one little tier. And then those top three guys just stick out to me. So, and Hopkins is three up there, man. He's definitely up there with them three dudes. Or two dudes, I should say. But how much do you think Will Fuller benefited just from having Hopkins as well? I mean, Will Fuller, can he really be a number one for the Texans team? Or is he just benefit last year on the years before and in the past of all those deep balls because everybody's so much blanketing on Hopkins, so he's getting open?
Mm-hmm. Well, we're going to have to see this season, right, Earl?
Right.
DeAndre's gone. He's gone. He's not coming back. So it's on exactly. Will to step up and show everybody that he's worthy, that he is that top, that number one wide receiver for the Houston Texans.
Right.
He's been battling through so many injuries in his career.
Right.
If he can stay healthy, and he's definitely got the talent and the skills to do it, and Deshaun can make him a number one wide receiver. Absolutely. You know that.
Oh, they can make, quarterbacks make receivers, that's for sure.
Goodness, yes. Earl, about 8 seconds left. The Celtics are up by 5. It may be about time to close that coffin.
It might be time on the champions, man. And Siakam, I hope you learned a lot from this series, because you were supposed to be the superstar to handle all that going down the stretch, and that's just going to make him better next year. I'm telling you, he's going to get into that level of being that next big superstar that can take over a game like that, because he was supposed to take over that game.
What did Reggie Miller do against the Knicks with 8 seconds left?
Don't even remember that. Yes, that's the big. He stole it. He shot a three. Bang! Went and stole the ball back. Shot the other three. Like going back down court. Like y'all some chill guard.
Yeah.
You gotta love Reggie, man. I used to love that kid. Oh, I should love him as a player. When he's he got on Jordan. He gave Jordan a taste of his own medicine down the stretch, pushed off on him, and hit that winning three. Oh man, I love that play. But yeah, Reggie used to do it, man.
Reggie was an assassin. Assassin. Oh gosh, I loved him.
I mean, you talk about enjoying the moment like that, being in clutch time. He was one of those dudes.
Yes.
And he didn't look like that type of dude coming out of UCLA. He's like, this scrawny little thing on me. Yeah, he was a deadly little man. That dude was, and not only deadly on the court, he wasn't scared of nobody. Was standing people's, remember that fight he had with Kobe on the court?
Yes.
He stood in there, he started, man, he was not scared of nothing.
Reggie was fearless.
Yeah, sure was. Love it. But see, these guys,
final.
It's a final, 92-87. Congratulations to the Boston Celtics getting through to the next round, which we're going to love this next one coming up.
Yes. But we knew this kind of game was going to be this kind of game in game sevens.
Absolutely.
Those always come down to tight ones. For them to hold Toronto to 16 points in the fourth quarter, that's an amazing defensive effort for the Boston Celtics.
Yes.
To hold the world champions to 87 points in a game seven.
In a game seven, yes. That's
wow.
I mean, on the flip side of that, holding them to 92 was not all that bad either. The Toronto's defense is good, but the champions.
They're two of the most.
Yeah, to take down a champion, it takes that type of valiant effort. Man, it takes that type of effort. So
as we know, these are two of the best defensive teams in the league, the Celtics and the Raptors. It's only befitting that neither team scores 100 points in game seven.
Exactly.
They held Kyle Lowry to 16 points. He shot 33%. VanVleet only shot 40%. Oh. He got 20 points. Siakam 13. That's defense right there.
That sure is. That's defense and pressure point in a moment of that game. I wonder who came down the stretch for Boston and finally came through, because Tatum had a rough time in that last game coming down the stretch. Yeah. He turned the ball over. He turned the rock over three straight times, and mental error type turnover. Not just somebody hit his arm. He was throwing it away, and I thought he got rattled a little bit.
Yeah, but in this game, he started off strong, Earl. Okay. He had 7 and 7. I think it was 9 points and 7 rebounds in the first quarter. So he almost had a double-double in the first quarter. He ended up with 29 and 12.
Okay, well, he did his thing. He did his thing.
29-12, 7 assists.
Cool.
Oh, the kid did his thing.
Absolutely.
How great would it be, Earl, to have a Celtics-Lakers NBA Finals again?
Oh, man.
Again. don't it's possible. Say
that. But it's possible. It's possible.
How great would that be?
That would be awesome. In another generation of Lakers and Celtics. A different different look of Lakers and Celtics. We saw it with Magic and Bird. We saw it with Kobe against Garnett. And then now we're going to see it. Hopefully, it might happen with this young team of these young Celtics and LeBron.
Tatum and Brown and LeBron and AD. Oh my gosh, goodness. That would be a great
That would be pretty good. That would be must-see TV for sure.
That would be. I mean, I know we're talking football. I'm sorry to get off track.
No, we're good. Yeah. Hey, this is how radio goes, man. With something live going on, man, you got to keep up to date with it. You got to break it. You got to let it be known. Appreciate that. That was good.
Yeah.
That's good. But let's.
And that's the good thing about broadcasting. At this time, we can talk about this stuff.
Absolutely. Let's jump back into the football thing. And we're going to get into the Cardinals, but I just want to ask you a real quick question, in your opinion. Of all the players that have switched teams, and there's a lot of them, but the key guys, I mean, the star guy, which one of those players are going to be the most impactful on their team and the result of it be a playoff run?
Wow.
I mean, I'm going to give you a few guys. Gurley, Brady, Hopkins, Rivers, Bridgewater, Cam Newton, just to name a few. But there's teams, guys that have changed teams that are on some key points, key positions for teams. I mean, Clowney going to Tennessee. Big. That's big.
That's huge.
I mean,
that's huge for Mike Vrabel and the Titans.
So
yes.
which one of these guys do you think could be in the playoffs taking that team to the next level to a playoff run?
You mentioned two quarterbacks, Tom Brady and Cam Newton. Newton taking over Tom Brady's role.
Yeah, switching roles. Yeah.
they just switching roles. Yeah. That'll be interesting because let's see what Cam Newton can do in a whole new system, what he can learn under Bill Belichick. Of course, he earned that role. He did what he needed to do. He came in and earned that number one starting role as the quarterback for the New England Patriots.
Okay.
We know what Tom can do. Six-time Super Bowl winner, probably the greatest quarterback to ever do this thing, ever hike a ball and throw to a wide receiver or a running back, the greatest guy to ever do this. Let's see what he can do in Bruce Arians' system.
Right.
We all know B.A. and what he can do. He's a quarterback whisperer.
Yeah.
He's had so many great quarterbacks in his career. Now he's got the greatest of all time in his system. And he's got Mike Evans. He's got Gronkowski. He's got he's got Leonard Fournette there. He's got so much talent at his disposal. Let's see what he can do actually in a division, like PLR said, and actually an actual good division with good teams in it. Can he beat the Falcons twice?
Can he beat
the Carolina Panthers twice?
Right.
Can he go to the Mercedes-Benz Superdome on Sunday and knock off Drew Brees and the New Orleans Saints?
Yeah, he ain't getting that easy six wins every year like he usually gets in that old division.
No, sir.
Yeah, I agree with that. But those are good choices.
Another name you threw out, Todd Gurley. I want to see what he does.
That's the one that was in my head. Good call.
You pick Gurley too?
I got Gurley because I'm going those three words that always come to caveat when it comes to Gurley. If he's healthy.
Or can he stay healthy?
Yeah.
Four words.
Can he stay healthy? But he can be the guy that leads the Atlanta Falcons if he stays healthy. Because if he's back to Gurley the way he was in the Rams, oh my goodness, that would be awesome to see because the Atlanta Falcons are missing that running game type of guy. I mean, what happened to Devontae Freeman?
I don't know. He was
on top. Next thing you know, he was just in the cellar. What the heck? He ain't even on a team right now. So Gurley can come in and be what he was, what Freeman was when they went on the Super Bowl run, and they could very well be right in the mix of that thing, man. Because you know the NFC's a toss up right now. There's no runaway leader right now. No, I'm not even giving that to the 49ers. They're not the same team. So the NFC's a toss up right now. So I would go with.
I agree.
I'm gonna go with the Falcons, and I'm also gonna throw the Cardinals in there with Hopkins because when you think about it, they added another team to the playoff run. So you're talking that seventh team could come in that playoff 8-8, 9-7. Cardinals can pull off a 9-7 record and make it in that wild card. So I mean, who knows?
Possible, yeah.
So it's all possible. And then when that guy being the X factor, he's going to be for that team. And like I said, he was a decoy in Houston. He's going to be a decoy here, too. You're going to be able to use him in many ways to set up other stuff. So I would imagine that, man, they can get in that spot, too. The NFC's up for grabs. Like I said, it's up for grabs.
As talented as that offense is, I want to see the onus is on the defense. We talked about that with PLR earlier today.
Yes, yes.
Can the defense step up and meet that challenge? Can they equal, if not succeed, what the offense is capable and what we know and hope that the Arizona Cardinals offense can do? Can the defense step up and be just as good, if not better?
Man, I love your transitions. You know exactly where we be going. You're hitting the right on point. The next point I have on my list, you're going right to it. Like,
I didn't even see your list.
You're setting me up. I know. I'm saying you just been doing this thing for so long. You're like throwing a softball up, and I'm on the tee just knocking them out. So, yeah, speaking of the defense, and the depth chart came out before, of course, this week. And all throughout training camp up until this week, we've been told the inside guys that I got on the inside for the Cardinals that I dig into, I've been told Isaiah Simmons was going to be on the field starting against Kittle, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. Depth chart comes out, he's on the second team. Campbell is going to be starting. Right move? Yes, that's the right move, right? I mean, you don't just throw a rookie in that kind of fire. And I was always concerned about that when I was on the show with PLR and all my shows last week. This kid, mm-hmm. you're going to be throwing him into the fire against that tight end. You can steer his career in so many different ways if you mess this thing up. You want to ease him into this thing. Let's see if he has the star mind where he can erase things and come right back. Let's ease into that. So that was the right move, right?
I agree. Yeah, Devondre Campbell, let him have that starting job and let Isaiah learn.
Right.
And eventually, it would have been different if they had a preseason, Earl. And then Cliff Kingsbury could have really evaluated Isaiah and saw him in those four games. And then he could have said, I'm liking what I'm seeing from Isaiah in these four games.
Absolutely.
Maybe he did earn that right inside linebacker spot, or maybe he did not earn it. But for the fact that they don't have anything other than Clemson film on him and what they've seen in practice at training camp over at State Farm Stadium, they really don't have an idea of what Isaiah can do against NFL level talent. But he will definitely get his time because you and I both know this kid is all world. He is a phenomenal defensive player, and his time will come.
Absolutely.
But like any other rookie, he's got to bide his time and learn, and then he'll get some OJT.
Yep. We had our first COVID-19 put on the shelf today for the Cardinals. A key guy, our receiver, Keyshawn Johnson, has to go into COVID protocol. He's on the COVID list right now, so that's going to be what? 14 days or
14 days.
Yes.
Yeah.
14 days. So he's going to be out. Excuse me.
And that's tough because he's behind Fitz on that, that depth chart.
Yes. Yes. And so they didn't bring any guys in, which is, they're going with who they got, which is fine, fine, but that's the first guy to hit COVID-19. And then now when you think about this game that's supposed to be coming up on Sunday, the fires that are going on in LA in California, I should say, in California, period. In the Bay Area, there's some fires that could make the air quality not well enough to play a football game. So there's some things that the Cardinals and the 49ers are trying to work hand in hand to figure out. We can make this game a Monday night game. We can make this game a Sunday night game, or we could flip.
They can come here.
Yeah, we can flip it. Come
and here, bring it
here, and then we'll go to you guys on the next one. So all that has to be done within the next few days. So logistically, you're going, that's a nightmare on a team, right? I mean, both those teams are going to be going through the same thing, which is good, but the traveling team is going to have it worse. If it's us traveling there or them traveling here, he's going to be like, man, we wasn't expecting this.
And if they're going to decide to play the game in Glendale at State Farm Stadium, they have to decide like tomorrow, because
quick.
The Cardinals would have to, they have to get on a charter flight and fly to Santa Clara tomorrow.
Right. Tomorrow's the traveling day. Yes.
Tomorrow's
our
travel day.
Yeah.
So if they're doing it Sunday, they have to flip all these travel plans around. Then the 49ers have to get on their charter flight and come here. So there's so many logistics at play right now.
Yes. Logistics is going to be really key. They have to play this thing really close because they're keeping an eye on, what the fires are doing and, will it be clear enough? And when you think the atmosphere playing football, I think back to Ryan Clark from the Pittsburgh Steelers, or who was that was on that couldn't play in certain weather. They couldn't play in Mile High. When they go to Denver, he couldn't play because of the altitude. And I think it was Ryan Clark. And then our guy, John Brown, was dealing with the sickle cell thing. And you think about those things, that type of air quality is not only going to affect the game where you can play it or not, it's going to affect those guys that got those type of ailments playing.
Yeah, respiratory.
Yeah, respiratory stuff. Yeah. And so, man, that's like, how are they going to, it's look like this could come down to the last day before game day they have to make a decision.
Well, tomorrow's the last day before game day, Earl.
Yeah,
they've got to make that decision tomorrow.
Tonight.
Tonight.
Yeah.
Like now.
Because we're on a plane tomorrow. And, okay, here it goes. If you get on a plane tonight and you're in Santa Clara, then your decision-making has to be done there in Santa Clara. You can't say, let's go fly back home.
Yeah.
It's going to be.
Yeah, you can't have the Cardinals come out there and then you decide, oh, we're going to turn around and we're going to play in Glendale. Then, again, like you said, they have to jump back on a charter and fly back here. And then the 49ers have to jump on a plane and come here. That is just a disaster
from
a logistical standpoint.
Too much.
It's too much.
Yeah, so I would imagine they got something in hand to just go ahead and play either Monday or Sunday night. That way, the nighttime, is a lot.
Wow, that'd be three
awesome,
Monday night games. That'd
be awesome,
though.
That'd be heck of awesome. I would definitely bypass the other two because those matchups to me are not all that great. Well,
now Pittsburgh, New York, and Tennessee, Denver.
Yeah, it's like, what is that? You know, that's kind of like with all the matchups we got this first week, we end up with that on Monday night. But anyway, I'm looking at this.
I would have put Brady and Breeze on Monday night.
Yeah, that Cowboys and Rams game Cowboys on Rams? Sunday night should have been Monday night.
But that makes sense. Sunday night football, you open it up SoFi Stadium. You got a $5 billion stadium. Bring that out on Sunday night football.
Okay, yeah, that's
brilliant.
Yeah, that is
brilliant move.
That is brilliant. Looking at this game, though, the 49ers and Cardinals, and like I said earlier, I don't think this 49er team is that much dominant like they used to be. I think defensive coordinators can and have figured them out and watched them on tape throughout this whole offseason and know exactly what they're going to bring. But here's a key thing about the matchup with the Cardinals, Ed. Last year, the Cardinals took two steps forward because they should have beat that team at least once. At least once. Mm-hmm. And then the whole thing was stop the 49ers running game and force Jimmy G to beat you and you win. Well, that the opposite happened to us. Both games with them. We stopped the run, but we let Jimmy beat us on with Kittle and Emmanuel Sanders down the stretch of those games. There were two games. We opened up one of those games, a 16-point lead, and we let it go away. We opened up 16-0 and let that game get away from us. The other game, we were up 26-23 in the fourth quarter with 2 minutes left, and we let that game get away. And Jimmy G was the key of getting the ball deep on us because we couldn't cover the tight end. And we couldn't cover the screens. And we couldn't cover nothing he was throwing against us. So it was like, if we could come in and do exactly what we did, held them, the last game we played, that we held them to 34 yards rushing. Can you believe that? If we can do that again, the first game we held them to 101, the second game 34, we can play in that range somewhere around that average of those two numbers, stop that run, and finally have something to keep up with these tight ends, this game could get ugly. This game could get ugly on the offensive end because Cardinals, I don't think, can be stopped on the offensive end. It's going to be some time where they get rolling, but I think they're going to – like it took the Chiefs some time to get their stuff rolling. And I think we're going to feel it out for first quarter or so and then get rolling. So what do you think? I mean, 49ers, are they the same powerhouse to you, or has the Cardinals actually just come up that high now that we're just a step behind them?
I think they're just a step behind them.
Yeah, I do too.
San Francisco's defense is phenomenal. They have some really good players on all phases of that defense.
Yes,
but offensively, Deebo Samuel, he's okay. Mm-hmm. Kendrick Bourne, okay.
All right.
He's all right.
Yeah.
Raheem Mostert, he's good.
Yeah.
He's good. He's a good running back.
Yes.
But again, it all comes to George Kittle. You look at that tight end position, his name just blinks there. And they've got the former Washington football tight end, Jordan Reed, there.
Mm-hmm.
He's good when he's healthy.
Yes.
When he's healthy,
yes.
He's good. He's like Todd Gurley.
Right.
If he stays healthy, he's good. But if you shut down George Kittle, that offense does not scare me.
It does not. They're coming in there beat up already. We don't know if Ayuk's going to play. We already know Debo's out. So their receiving core is already banged up. So, man, this could be a prime for – I don't even like to call it an upset, but I call it an upset when I did the picks yesterday. But it's going to be an upset for me, I guess. But when you think about it, they're pretty much almost on an even playing field with the 49ers.
I believe so, and it would be an upset because they are the reigning NFC champions.
Absolutely.
If they play in Santa Clara or whether they play here, if they beat the 49ers, that is a huge upset. And what it is – that puts them 1-0 in the NFC West.
Yes.
Week one, you get that early.
You get that one.
Test, Earl.
And
yes.
Then you go on and play Washington the next week. You'd be 2-0. That'd be a good start.
That would be a good start.
Oh, man, time is running out to get this analyzation of this, continuing on this game. I'm pretty sure we're going to see it Sunday, of course, if it takes place.
If they play it, yes.
And then, of course, Sunday night I do a recap of the Cardinals game on the show. I call it a casual look. I just do a casual look at what happened on the game for a few 15-minute section real quick. I don't go into depth and no numbers and all that stuff and deep stuff. It's just a casual look.
Brother, if you need a guest,
pun intended. But yes, a casual look is you're definitely welcome to come in and just kind of look at that game. Let's just get this out of our system because we just saw this game, you know. But that's the reason why I got that show there just for 15 minutes or so, just to, you know, look at that. But that's what will be happening on the weekend. But I want to close this show tonight with something, a segment we normally do. We go back in the day, this day in history. And of course, 9/11 is this day in history. But we talk about for sports. This day in history and sports.
Sports Almanac.
What we're gonna do right here is go back. Way back. Back into time.
That's a 5 seconds left in the game. Over. You believe in miracles? Yes!
Get ready to duck it down, Buck. Get ready to duck it down, Buck.
Back down memory lane.
It's Lillard. He got the shot off. Throw it down. And the Blazers win the series.
Remember.
I remember it vividly.
This is a segment we call Sports Almanac. We go back into the history of sports on this day in history.
And I heard Mr. Otis. Down, boy. Mr. Otis.
Get ready to take you down, boy. Get ready to take you down, boy. I love that intro, man. That's my production work, so I got to take a bow
that's
for
great.
That one, man. But
good,
in this day in history, there's so much, of course, all predicated on U.S. Open because of where we are, this time of the month. So U.S. Open, and when I think back all those tennis players back in the 70s and 80s that dominated like the people are dominating today, I remember those names, Steffi Graf. Chris Everett. I mean, those names. Martina Navratilova. Those ring out
yes.
to me. I'm like, I remember that. That was my era of the people dominating in tennis. Then you go to the men's side. Pete Sampras, John McEnroe, and you just keep naming them and keep going. But for the most part, they're the ones that dominated around this time. So 1976, Chris Everett won the U.S. Open in 1976. Then you jump to 19, right after her in 70 and 80, I'm sorry, 80, no, 93, I'm sorry, 93, Steffi Graf wins the U.S. Open. You can keep just going back and forth. All these guys didn't want it, back and forth. So tennis was really dominant for these guys back then. They held it down for years. But another thing that happened in sports history, 1985, Pete Rose, Cincinnati Reds, gets a career hit, 4,192 against Eric Show and broke Ty Cobb's record. When you hear Pete Rose in baseball, shouldn't he continue to be, I mean, shouldn't he finally get over this thing and get him back where he belongs in baseball? At least
I think it's
past
yes,
time,
I think
right?
It's way past time.
Yeah, I mean, come on, man. The guy had done... pretty much served his, and then when you see why he's not in baseball for the gambling thing, and then all these other egregious things you see in sports, you're like, come on, you gotta let this guy back in here at some point, right?
Right. So many worse things have happened
yes.
since Pete Rose gambled
goodness.
On his own team, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Some way worse. Here's another name for you in tennis. U.S. Men's Opening, Andre Agassi. Man, did he hold it down or what back then?
Yes, he did. Agassi was my boy.
I love these old names. They just make me go, I remember those guys. And I wasn't into tennis, but I remember like, dang, he won again. He won again. He won again. You know, it was like, those are the guys that held it down for me. 1994.
Yeah, Agassi was on one back then.
Yeah, Agassi in 94 won the U.S. Open, his first U.S. title. He beats Michael Stich of Germany at the time. So that was a cool little ordeal back then. Of course, Serena in 99 started to come on the scene. She won her first U.S. Open then. And then we already know Roger Federer is still holding it down today. He goes back there with Agassi. He's still there today. So
he's a Larry Fitzgerald of tennis.
Basically, him and Novak Djokovic.
Yeah,
one of the
Djokovic.
Two. Yeah, so those that's pretty much what's going on in this day in history. It's not so much everything is going around pretty much tennis in the U.S. Open, but not much happening. Not much I've seen NBA wise on this day because I guess we'd probably be done by this time, right?
Yeah, the NBA Finals are done by now.
Yeah, supposed to be done by now. So yeah.
Yeah, the NBA Finals is done in June.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. So yeah, that's it, man. That's this 9/11, and you already know the history of this 9/11 back when it happened. 9/11 took place in the terrorist attack.
19 years ago.
19 years ago. That is something else, man.
Amazing.
Hey, Ed, man, I appreciate you coming in. And I want to, if you don't mind, man, get ready for next week because I'm going to need you next week, bro. Need you next week.
I'm with you, man.
I appreciate you, man, and your loyalty. And
we got to get Brother Earl on here, too. Brother PLR on here, too.
Oh, yeah. He'll be in at some point. I'm pretty sure in these new series that are coming out, this L.A. series going to happen. And that Eastern one, he's going to have a lot to say, I'm sure. But you have been listening to the Kazual Sportz Show and Bird Gang. It goes by so fast. It goes by so fast. So much to talk about. So much to get into. But we can only go an hour. So tune in to us next week. We got a whole week to do it all again. So we'll catch you next week, Bird Gang. From Earl Burnett, Ed Cole. Peace out.